see Mary and Joseph bringing Jesus to the temple. He was going to be the Messiah. I doubt if any of your children are going to be the Messiah. But what I do know is God's desire for your children is that they're not only your children, but they would also become His children. You cannot make your kids become Christians, but moms and dads have the greatest significant influence on the lives of their children spiritually than anybody else in the world. It is from you that your children will either have a desire for God or a hatred towards Him. It will be because of you that they want to explore more or that they want to run away from. And so the challenge that I have to you, Derek and Nikki, is number one, do you love the Lord your God? Are you willing to raise your children in a home that will not only teach but show that you love God? Good. Will you provide an environment which will be open to questions that they can ask you about God? And you may not know all the answers, but you can investigate and find the answers. Are you willing to have a home with that kind of environment? Yes. Terrific. Do you have one who's already asking lots of questions? Attaboy, give me five. You keep asking those questions, all right? You keep asking them. All right. Hey, you don't have to leave yet. Stay right up there, all right? I need my picture made with you in just a minute again, all right? All right, to the grandparents, you are listening to your son and daughter talk about, not about whether they'll take care of their kids physically. I have no doubt, look at how they're dressed. I have no doubt, unless that's an abuse when they get older, all right? But I have no doubt these kids will be taken care of with everything that Derek and Nikki can provide for them from a human perspective. But as you as grandparents, are you willing to support your son and your daughter in providing a spiritual environment for your grandkids as well? If you are, say we do. Terrific. May I have beautiful Winnie Lou? And you need to know, I love that name because my grandmother's name was Winnie. Oh, yes, my grandmother. Hello. Oh, you are so beautiful. You're just going to nestle in? Isn't this a good look? Isn't this a good look? All right. I'm so excited about this. You know what I want to do? I want to sit down here, right here on the step, and I want these two boys, one on each side of me. All right? Can we do that? Let's see if I can. I might not be able to get up, but let me get down. Oh. You can sit down. All right. Can you hold your sister's hand? Can you hold your sister's hand? Can you hold your sister's hand right here? All right. And you guys just put your hand on each other right here. All right? We'll just make a chain. Reach down there and hold it. All right. Let's just pray together. All right? Our Father in heaven, we are so grateful for this moment that we get to spend with the Pierce family. We thank you for this beautiful new life that you have brought into their world, Miss Winnie Lou. We have no idea what her future is, but we know the desires and the plans that you have for her. You desire that she be your daughter. You desire that she be an influencer of life in the world in which she's a part of. You desire that she be a representation of you to the rest of the world. And you promise to give her blessings and joy and contentment and delight. You don't promise her money or a house or a great job, but you do promise her peace, joy, and contentment if she'll trust you. Thank you for her mom and dad who are willing to spend this time in teaching their children how to love the Lord. I pray for the grandparents that they'll continue to encourage them in what they do. May you continue to give her brothers inquisitive minds into the things of the Scriptures. We thank you for this. We trust you for it all. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Oh, thank you, guys. All right, you're welcome. What a nice young man. Thank you. Give me five. Lay it on me, man. All right. All right. Hold on. Let me have a good hold. All right. Ah! All right. Oh. If you need a babysitter, we'll take care of this one. All right. Okay. We'll take care of this one.
Just this one or all three?
Oh, bring them all. Okay. Bring them all. Yeah. We have a stall that we can, you know. Put them, yeah. And on behalf of New Hope Church, to remember this day, you have two more of these that go along with the other two that you've got. And we also have a beautiful quilt made by the women here at New Hope Church as a gift, all right, for your daughter. All right. So it is our pleasure. All right, I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward as we have our tithes and offering, and our worship team's going to come back up here in just a moment and lead us in our worship. Would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, thank you for the life that we get to share in you. Thank you for the special moments that we get to have with friends and church family. I trust this day will be long remembered. I know that Winnie Lou will not remember anything about this day, but I hope as they see the pictures down the road, as mom and dad and grandma and granddad share with this beautiful little girl, they'll say, hey, this was a day in which we committed you to the Lord. I trust that you'll follow him with your life. Father, thank you for the privilege of being part of worship today, and thank you for the message that you would like to challenge us with. May our hearts be open to your word. We trust you for all this in Christ's name. Amen. Last Sunday was a bit of an unusual Sunday for us at New Hope. Had a lot of interesting comments and some dialogue and some visit with folks, and don't have time to review what we did last week, but if you missed it, go to the website, watch it, but don't stop after the first sermon. Last week there really were two sermons, all right? And believe it or not, they were shorter than most of my one sermons. But it was just an interesting way in which God worked it out. On the heels of that, I didn't want to leave you dangling. I didn't want to leave you, okay, what now? And so for the next 5 or 6 weeks, we're going to try to look at the what now on the heels of kind of what we talked about last Sunday. For those of you who weren't here last Sunday, things will start to make sense in a few minutes, so don't worry about it. What we're going to look at over the next few weeks is a theme called Unseen and Twisted. And it's really the analysis of why we're in the predicament we are personally, as a state, as a country, as a world. It's as a result of that which is unseen and very, very twisted. And I hope by the end of the next 4, 5, or 6 weeks, we'll have a better handle on what all of that means. With the help of guys like Chuck Swindoll and Charles Stanley and Andy Stanley, they have made a big difference in preparing for this particular series. So along with the activity of Christ in us, I give them a lot of kudos for doing some much-needed legwork that helped make today's sermon a whole lot easier. You see, the most dangerous lies are the ones that you and I never notice. They're the lies that can twist our thinking in ways that we would never expect, and they can leave us with a life that we never imagined or even hoped for. Our ability to recognize them can spell the difference between happiness and the loss of those things that we hold most dear. Do you recognize the twisted lies in your world? In this series, over the next few weeks, I hope we will expose some common ways that God's truth, that God's words get twisted, and how we can recognize those things and personally as well as collectively overcome them. You see, every one of us has the potential. Every one of those lies, those twisted distortions of truth, has a way of destroying our relationships, of clouding our decision, and of distorting our perception, first of all, of who He is, and second of all, what He desires out of our life. We're going to look, beginning with today. Today's title is All Is Not As It Seems. Next week, we're going to take a look at something we used to say on the playground. Says who? Make me. Did you ever say that? Then we're going to talk about facing forward. In other words, turn around. Stop looking backwards. Number three, we'll look at, but Tim, what you're talking about, that's only physical. That might be a PG-13 rated sermon. That's got you interested. Come back. Last of all, we'll look at it's no mistake. What I did, what you did, was no mistake. So let's jump in. All is not as it seems. In the late eight, if you want to open your Bibles in a few minutes, I'll be in John chapter 8, and at the end of the sermon, I'll be in Ephesians chapter 6. So Gospel of John chapter 8, letter to the church at Ephesus, book of Ephesians chapter 6. In the late 1800s, doctors and scientists believed something called spontaneous generation. It's the idea that living organisms could suddenly pop up anywhere from non-living organisms, and this pretty much explained disease in the 1800s. That from out of nowhere, disease could just occur, and doctors didn't assume that it was related to anything. Suddenly, here's a skin disease on a person's body. In many cases, disease would sweep a family, sweep a community, sweep a countryside, and kill thousands and thousands. The assumption was these diseases just popped up and they were random acts of destruction. It was providential and in some cases, God ordained, people thought. And there was no investigation to determine how these diseases might be related to or how they were transmitted on. Interesting. Because it was assumed a spontaneous generation that a non-living organism could suddenly produce some sort of living organism that turned into a disease. Now, my strong suit was not necessarily biology and science. Not my strongest area, all right? But I do remember this next name, and I think you will too. Louis Pasteur. Everybody recognizes that name, all right? He came along and he said, no, spontaneous generation is not true. You've been believing it. We think we have proved it, but it isn't the truth. And that there are invisible organisms that you can actually carry these diseases, and they can be carried by the wind. They can be passed on by touching someone's skin. They can live in your food. They can live on different kinds of surfaces. And that these diseases are not just cropping up randomly from non-living organisms, but they are invisible organisms. There's an invisible world that's impacting the visible world we see. And this invisible world of germs, as they would eventually be called, these microorganisms, as we would later call them, these invisible, we don't want to call them germs anymore because it might hurt their feelings. These invisible microorganisms are everywhere and you can't see them. And this unseen world is impacting the seen world, and it has the potential to destroy our lives, our families, our communities, and create all kinds of pestilence that goes all over the world and kills hundreds and thousands of people. All because of something you cannot see. And so Pasteur put forth what became known as the germ theory of disease. The germ theory of disease, the idea that invisible microorganisms can impact our world. Now, this science caught on pretty quick among this close-knit group of medical community that he was a part of. And you know what they started doing? They started washing their hands before they worked on people, all right, medically. They began separating people from each other, doing things called quarantine. They began watching to see if there was a transmission from one person to another of a common disease. But many at that time in the medical and scientific community and people outside that medical and scientific community thought, those guys are crazy. You're telling us that something we can't see that impacts us and the things that we can see. You're telling us something that's invisible can float through the air, land on my food and infect it. That something you can't see floats through the air, land on a person's skin, and you're telling me I can get a disease from something I can't see. There's this invisible world we're surrounded by, and all of these invisible living organisms are unfriendly and they impact our visible world. To which Pasteur said, absolutely, absolutely correct. Nowadays, what Pasteur taught then is not a theory. Right now, it's fact. We all believe in germs. Everybody in this room, everybody listening to this message, we believe there is an invisible world that impacts our visible world. That's why all of us have a lot of this in our homes. Okay? We got mouthwash to kill the germs in our mouth. All right? So we don't have, we got this so that we can wash our hands. My question is, how many of you have a bottle of this in your pocket or purse, small one, right now? Okay? See, y'all believe in the invisible world. Okay? And that it has an impact on our visible world. We're addicted to this stuff. We're addicted to this because we not only believe in germs, not only do we believe there's something that we can't see that impacts us, we also believe that they're dangerous. We believe that it could be life-threatening. We know now, because of medical discoveries and because of what happened since the late 1800s, that these invisible microorganisms can wipe out populations. And you never see it coming because they're an invisible world of germs. Past couple of years, most of you know I've been to the Ivory Coast, Africa. We carry around little bottles of hand sanitizer in our pocket all the time. We want it readily available. We can use it at any moment. Little squirt. Keep our hands clean because we might touch our mouth and we don't want to end up sick. Why? Because the invisible impacts the visible and it can become quite dangerous. Now here's the rub for us today. The Bible. The Bible says there's another invisible world. There's another invisible world that doesn't simply impact us physically, but there's an invisible world that impacts us relationally. It impacts our thinking. It impacts our worldview. It impacts our attitude. It impacts our attitudes towards morality and purity. It impacts our attitudes towards finances and relationships, our marriages. It impacts how we date, how we do business, how we interact with each other. It impacts everything there is about us. It can be physically life-threatening. It can be emotionally life-threatening. It can be relationally life-threatening. It is this invisible world. It is all around us. It impacts us everywhere, and it impacts everything we do. And yet, as we talk about it, some of you sitting here today are going to tend to resist this idea. Just as contemporaries of Pasteur resisted germs, you are going to want to resist an invisible spiritual world that exists. We're like the people that lived in the 1800s and said, wait a minute, you're telling me there's something I can't see and it's going to make a difference in my life? There's something around me that floats through the air, can land mysteriously and miraculously wherever it wants to, and suddenly a living organism crops up because of something invisible? That is difficult for me to believe. What we're going to talk about for the next few weeks is a little difficult to believe as well. But you see, the same Bible that says love one another, and we all love that part, don't we? I mean, even people who don't read the Bible, what do they say about our world? Can't we all just get along and love one another? We all like that. The Bible, the same Bible that says, husbands, love your wives. All the wives love that verse in the Bible, all right? And the same Bible that says, children, obey your... I've never met a parent yet that doesn't love that verse. And the same Bible that says you can know God by putting your faith in Him, and we all love that part. That same Bible and many of the same books in this Bible, all those things I've just quoted are true, but there's more. This Bible tells us there's an invisible world we need to watch out for. There's an invisible world that impacts your visible world every single day. We don't need a microscope to discover it. We don't need a microscope to see it. Do you know what we need? All we need is a rearview mirror. Because all you have to do is look back in your own life, like I've looked back in my life, and see those moments where we've said, how could I have been? You got a rearview mirror too? You've said that? How could I have been so confused? How could I have thought that was a good thing when looking from this perspective, it was clearly a bad thing? How could I have thought that was a good idea when, man, oh, what a bad idea that was? How could I have been so deceived? How could things have been so twisted in my mind? How could I have been so confused? I mean, how in the world did I think that relationship was going to go anywhere? Why in the world would I think that approach to finances, no budget, was going to take me somewhere good? Why could I not see that that wasn't a pastime, but that was a pathway that led to a habit that I'm going to have to deal with now for the rest of my life? Why could I not see in the moment? I mean, looking back, it's clear. But in the moment, when he stood there, when she stood there, when the opportunity was there, when I was alone, when I was with them, it seemed right. But looking back, we were all crazy. Yeah. We should have seen that one coming, huh? How could I have been so confused and so deceived in my thinking? How is it things got so twisted and here I am now paying the price physically and emotionally and relationally and financially for decisions I made in a moment when it was if my head was in a cloud? Maybe you don't need a rearview mirror. Maybe you just need a mirror right now because you're right in the middle of it at the moment. I mean, you're making decisions in moments of what you think are sanity. Then you go and get with a group of people or you get with a particular person or in a certain environment. It's like you lose your mind. It's like you abandon everything you believe, and in those moments you are so confused about your thinking. It is now so twisted. You talk yourself into things you know you have no business doing. Does anybody relate to this? Have you been there Have you experienced it? Good. And then you come out and you regain your sanity and you focus and your perspective and you look in the mirror and you say, I did it again. What is wrong with me? Suddenly things make sense that didn't, and things that didn't suddenly don't make sense. Things that are so clearly wrong in some environments, they make perfect sense in those wrong environments. And then I come out and I regret the consequences and I'm thinking, man, what is wrong? Or if that doesn't do it for you, if that's a little too personal, then just look around. And I don't mean here. I don't mean here. But like all of us do it sometimes, look around to other people. But people that you love, people that you have a desire for the best for, and you watch them make decisions, and do you ever think, why can't they see this the way I do? This is obviously wrong. And they make a terrible decision. But for them, it makes perfect sense. They argue their case, and their logic is so twisted. Their thinking is so fouled up. And the rest of us stand on the periphery of their lives, and we say, man, guys, I think you're really going to regret this. You may regret this for the rest of your life. What are you thinking? But in their world, in that little capsule in which they make decisions, it makes perfect sense. You see, there's a twist. There's a deception. There's a way of thinking that only makes sense in the moment. And when we look back historically as a culture, as a people, as a country, and we think, how could we have been so confused? Nationally, internationally, many times our confusion and the twist that thwarts our thinking and that confuses our thoughts, it results in the deaths of people. It results in the annihilation of relationship. It results in the death and sometimes of persecution of people. And we come to our senses and we think, what were we doing? How could we have supported that? How could we have thought that was the right thing to do? It's real simple, and we're going to see, I hope, over these next few weeks how the Bible answers that for us, because there's a twist. There's a confusion. There's a distortion of truth that's just enough to get us in trouble. Not so much as to scare us away. And the ones behind the twist will never tip their hands. They don't want to become too obvious. For were they to become too obvious too soon, we would just run from them and they would have no impact. I wish that had made a little diagram. Let's say you want to go from point A to point B, and it's on a straight line, all right? But at point A, you decide, I'm going to make one little decision. It's not big, it's little. And right here at the beginning, it's not much of a change of direction. But the farther you go down that path, you wanted to go here, but you're here. But the farther you go down that path, the farther away you end up down here from where your destiny was supposed to be. It looked simple then. Here you say, wow, had I known this is where I was going to end up, I would have never made that decision down here. But that's because this invisible world, this spiritual germ world, twists the truth only a little bit, because the intent is not where we are now, but where we will end up somewhere down the road. The interesting thing is, not everybody falls for this kind of deception and twist, though. There are people, and maybe you're one of them, maybe you've met somebody like this. There are people that somehow are able to navigate the minefields of the culture that we live in. They navigate the deception, and they just rarely make bad decisions. They do marriage differently, and we envy them for it. They don't buy into the culture's definition of how you're supposed to do what you do and how you handle morality and how you handle money and how you have a worldview. They just do things differently. And in our moments of sanity, we think, wow, I want a marriage like theirs. I want to date like that couple does. What, Russell Wilson's getting made a lot of fun of right now? I don't know what the full outcome is. I don't know Russell Wilson very well, but he says, we're pure in our relationship. Here's a big-time, well-paid guy, and he said, I'm not going to defile this relationship before marriage. Being ridiculed for that. And yet, there are others who say, wow, I wished I could do one like that. I'd like to be emotionally free. I'd like to be secure. If you want to read a guy out of the Bible like that, read about Joseph. Don't have time to talk about him today, but he's one of those, man, out of the Old Testament. He was like that. But let's face it, the Josephs are the exceptions. They're not the rule, because we live in a culture that's been twisted, and the truths are so evident sometimes in a room like this, in a conversation like this, at a time like this. Once we step outside these doors, though, back into our worlds, those truths that seem so obvious to us here, when we get out there and we try to articulate it out there, Now is when we say, well, maybe it's not all that clear to me. We don't lose all of them. We just lose enough of them to where ultimately down the road we lose our way. We lose our place. We lose our perspective. Now, as obvious as maybe some of this seems, Jesus gives us some real specific insights into the unseen world. And if you brought your Bibles and you've already turned to John chapter 8, and I have got to hustle here, I've got to warn you, his explanation of this unseen world is unsettling. That's the easiest way I can describe it, is it's unsettling. In John chapter 8, interesting chapter, one of the most famous verses of the Bible comes out of John chapter 8, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Politicians quote that verse and they don't even know what's in the Bible. All right? And know the truth, and the truth will set you free. That's in John chapter 8. It's an incredible verse and nobody argues with it. That certainly intertwines into this conversation we're going to have over the next few weeks. That verse is there. The book of John also has the most famous verse in the Bible in it. For God so loved the that he gave his only begotten, that whosoever believeth in him would not, but have everlasting. Yeah, it's a great verse. We love it. It's in John. There are so many great things in this gospel. There are verses you could just love. Even if you're not a Christian, there's some great stuff. We find Jesus in the book of John in every chapter and every verse. We get Jesus' take on the unseen world, and I'll be honest, it's very unsettling. In fact, when I read you these verses in just a moment, some of you are going to say, whoa, 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 Tim, here's where I got to draw the line. I'd like to be a Christian, but I want no part of what you're saying today. I like the fact that I love Jesus. And I like the fact that we all ought to love one another and go to heaven when we die, but I'm not buying into what you're preaching today. Here's what I want you to say. I want you to think about as we move into these verses. You can't really do what the book of John asks. You can't do that with any of the Gospels. You can't say, I want this part of John, but I don't want this part of John. I want this part of Jesus, but I don't want that part of Jesus. It's all or it's nothing. If you love what Jesus says about the parts that are easy, then you have to at least pause and consider embracing the parts that are hard. And I tell you this whole subject matter, sometimes I could resist this, but at the end of today's message, I'll tell you why I don't. Here Jesus takes on the invisible world. Let me set it up. In John chapter 8, Jesus is having a conversation with some religious leaders. He's already far enough into his ministry to where he's done miracles. He's taught great truths. And people are saying, hey, this guy might be the Messiah. And the ones who should have been saying that first are the ones that are resisting Jesus as the Messiah. They are so twisted in their own view of truth that they can't see it right in front of them. So Jesus is having a conversation, and here's what he's saying. He's saying, look, after all you've seen and all you've heard, you do not recognize that I come from God. After all you've seen me do and you've heard me say, you do not recognize that I am the Messiah. And here is their response. Oh, we don't need you to come from God. We have Abraham as our father. We're related to Abraham. We don't need to know anything about you. If God wanted to say something to us, he would have told Moses and Abraham. We don't have to listen to you, Jesus. Jesus now takes his gloves off. And in these next few verses, he's going to let them know why they are not able to recognize him as the Messiah. The ones who should have been the first to have recognized, because their thinking is twisted from an invisible world, they miss him. And Jesus says, okay, guys, you're not going to like this, but I'm going to tell you why it is that you don't recognize me. John 8:43, right in the middle of the conversation. Here's how it goes. Why is my language not clear to you? In other words, this is a summary statement. So why is it you don't get it? Is it because you were unable to hear what I'm saying? Are you deaf? No. He said, I'll tell you why you don't know who I am. Verse 44. You belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out his desires. Hey, guys, I'll tell you what. You don't recognize me for who I am because there is a deceiver and he has deceived you. In the face of overwhelming evidence, your thinking is twisted just enough that you take what I say and what I do and you describe it to somebody else but God. The problem is you have been influenced by, you are being deceived and under the power of your father, the devil. Now that was offensive. They had just finished saying, we follow our father Abraham, and Jesus is going, Abraham ain't your daddy, and the devil is the one who is your father. Man, try to work that into a conversation with somebody who's not getting it. I'm glad Jesus did it, because I'm not trying it. Verse 44, the rest of the verse, Jesus referred to Satan as he. I find it somewhat humorous. In our culture, people who want parts of the Bible but not all of it, they would like to soften God, and so they don't want to call him he anymore. They want to call him she. Yeah. Okay, it's true. I haven't noticed anybody writing an article or book saying we need to start calling the devil a she. Everybody's content leaving the devil a him, all right? Jesus said he. Some of you are saying, oh, it's just a figure of speech. Now, let's go on. He says he's not a truth teller, he's a liar. And here's what he says, he was a murderer from the beginning. Jesus is taking the people all the way back to the Garden of Eden. He's saying, guys, let me tell you, you've been talking about Abraham, but he's not your father, the devil is. And the devil committed murder in the garden, and you all, in a few months, are going to commit murder on a cross. Just as your father is a liar and a murderer, you are a liar and a murderer. Now that's what Jesus believed. You don't have to believe in this invisible enemy called the devil. You have a right not to believe it. I'm just telling you what Jesus believed. Jesus believed that the devil was actually a person, a he, an entity, the devil. Jesus believed that. And here's what Jesus believed about him. Jesus believed that he had an ultimate agenda, and it was murder. That his ultimate agenda is the destruction of human life that's supposed to reflect the character and the nature of God. And that means he will do it through deception. He's limited to distortion, to deception, destroying the destruction of human life and all that is valuable to us. He has only one tool. It's through confusing the human mind that we think what is right is actually wrong, and what is wrong is actually right. And that people do things that make absolutely no sense to anyone looking on, but it makes perfect sense to them. And at the end of the day, at the end, is the destruction of their soul, of that relationship, and maybe even their physical body. Another couple of glimpses into Jesus' view on this whole thing of this invisible world. He says in John chapter 14, verse 30, same book, a few chapters later, he's talking to his closest friends, some of the disciples, and he says, I'm not going to chat with you all much longer. Now check this out. Why? For the prince of this world is coming, and he has no hold on me. Jesus believed. This is tough. And he says, hey, I've got a few questions. Can you fill in the gaps? Some of you are going to say, Tim, this devil stuff, this invisible world, this unseen world, you really believe all that? I got to be honest, yeah, I do. I can't explain it all. I don't understand it. So here's a deal I want you to make with me. Because I'm already admitting to you I don't understand it all, don't come up and ask me to explain it to you when the sermon's over. Because there's a lot of things I can't explain, but I believe. You see, every Sunday morning I put one of these on. Okay? I put one of these on, and this thing's connected to my ear, right in front of my mouth. There's a little wire that goes down my back, and it goes into a little box that's in my hip pocket. And from there, it's not connected to anything. And yet what I say up front on this stage, out of my mouth, it gets sent through this little wire out my hip pocket, and it goes all the way back to the sound booth there in the back. And then it gets to that sound booth there, it puts it into that machine there, and it sends it all the way back up front so that it goes from the front to the back to the front so y'all in the back can hear it. I don't understand that. It doesn't change the fact that it is true. And all of that is happening in the invisible world. You don't see those sound waves going through, but yet it is happening. And Jesus said, you may not see the devil, but he is here. He is the prince of this world. Listen, in Luke chapter 4, this is one of the temptations that Jesus was tempted. The devil took him to the top of the mountain and said, I will give you all of these kingdoms if you will bow and worship me. The devil says, I have influence in this world, and I can share it with you. And Jesus said, I'll take no shortcut to my Father's will. You see, apparently, though he's been given authority in this world, he does not have control over everything. And that's where the truth of God, when you and I choose to believe this truth here, we can overcome and thwart the twisted deceptions of the evil one. This is all a little bit disconcerting, isn't it? To know there's this invisible spiritual world that is plaguing you and me every step of the way in life. But maybe it's helpful. Maybe it explains some things. Maybe it's something we need to learn to factor into our struggles with temptation. Or the weird thing where you have moments of clarity and you have moments of insanity and then you have moments of clarity again. I know what I need to do. Then it's like you go right out and do the opposite thing. It's where Paul says, I know what I ought to do, but I don't do it. And when I don't do it, I end up with doo-doo. That's Romans, okay? It's there. Go read the book. It's in there, all right? That's how this invisible world impacts us. Maybe there's something we can't see that influences us. 2 years after Jesus did this, and he said this, and sure enough, those men who claimed to be sons of Abraham and sons of David, they nailed Christ to a tree. 30 years later, the Apostle Paul, one of the smartest men of his day, begins writing to Christians and Christian churches. He understands what Jesus taught, and he takes all this and he writes letters to Christians, and the book of Ephesians is one of those letters that he writes, and he talks in that book about how to live lives, how to love children, how to love your spouses, how to do marriage, how to do business. It's a very relational book. And at the end of his book, here is what Paul says. These are the verses if you read them in isolation. It goes like this in chapter 6. Paul says, I want you to put on the full armor of God so that you can take a stand against who? The devil and his schemes. Do you know what Paul believed? The Apostle Paul believed the very same thing that Jesus believed. That there is a real living devil that we can't see, and he's sneaky. He's got schemes. He takes the truth and he twists it and he changes it enough so that it doesn't harm us immediately, but it will asphyxiate us over the long haul. Find some common ground, and then he'll lead us astray. Let's take appetites. All of you have one right now, huh? Your stomach's growling. You're waiting for me to hurry up and shut up so you can go have lunch. I'm not quite finished yet. 7 minutes. Let's take appetites. Those are good things, but let's twist them. And now your appetite becomes your addiction. Let's take desire. I like desires. Desires can be a very good thing. And let's twist the desire, and it now becomes greed. Let's take something that's appealing. Nothing wrong with things that are appealing, but let's take that which is appealing that's twisted, and now it becomes jealousy. Let's take appreciation and twist it, and it becomes lust. Haven't you ever heard a man say, I'm looking at a beautiful woman walking by, I'm just appreciating God's creation. Yeah. Appreciation becomes lust very, very quickly. Let's so twist people's view of God that they get mad at him. They make decisions based on their own anger, and then they blame God for the consequences of their own lousy decisions. That's a scheme. That's a plan. Verse 12 says, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood. It's not, ladies, you having trouble in your marriage? It's not just your husband that's the problem. It's not just your daughter, parents, that's the issue. It's not just you that's the problem. It's not your boss only that's the problem. Wait a minute. Paul says, wait. Remember to factor in. It's not just what you can see, but our struggle is against spiritual forces, authorities, the powers of a dark world. Paul, come on. You said some really cool stuff like 1 Corinthians 13, love is kind, love is gentle. You're going to tell me you believe in all this? Yes, I do. Now, if you listen to this whole thing, some of you, I know you're listening to this, and I know what you're thinking. Some of you are saying, Tim, I'm glad you're finally getting around to preaching on this stuff. I wasn't sure if you really believed in the devil. You hardly ever talk about it around here. And you're right, because I'd much rather talk about the original than the counterfeit. But sometimes we've got to expose the counterfeit so we even know that there is one out there. And so we're going to do that. Some of you are saying, Tim, I'm glad you're talking about this because I've been reading these verses and I've been getting confused. And I don't know, is this the devil? Is it me? What? Maybe part of my marriage, it's the devil. And so, Tim, you're giving me permission today to go home and say to my husband, dear, you're of your father, the devil. That's not what I'm necessarily recommending at the moment. That might be twisting it, all right? That's why I need to quit right here. I want to say something very quickly, though, to some of you who've come in today. Maybe you haven't been in church a long time, and you're saying, this is the reason I quit going to church, is because all the preachers ever did was talk about the devil. Give me one more minute. I totally understand, because what I'm talking about today is invisible. And besides, I know you've already got your explanations of why people do crazy things. of why they get addicted. You don't need a devil to figure that out. You've got your own explanation as to why your ex-wife and you couldn't get along. I mean, it was her, obvious. You have your own explanation of why your kids don't mind you. Okay? It's because of those crazy teachers at school. But you know, we've got enough situations in our world. How about a milkman who went into an Amish community and captured 10 young girls and shot 10 of them and killed 5 of them? How about a group of people who for 2 years planned on hijacking passenger planes and crashing them into business buildings to destroy hundreds and thousands? This is not somebody getting mad and doing something foolish in a moment. These are people who planned and organized and in some cases thought they were honoring God. That is twisted thinking. How in the world do things like this make sense? I don't understand child pornography and child prostitution. Those things don't make sense apart from an invisible world. And Jesus said, beware. There is an enemy out there who is roaring like a lion. You cannot see him, but he's seeking to devour you. And he will do it small bite at a time. It's why I often pray. I often lean hard into the teachings of Jesus and I say, Lord, help me to understand this book so that I can understand the times we live in better. I don't want to take the times and have them help me understand this book. That's what our Supreme Court just did. I want this book to help me and you understand the times and make decisions. There is a deceiver and a twister. And I'm not worried about what he might do to my physical body, but I am concerned with what he may do with this world. So for the next few weeks, we're going to look at some of the major twists, and we're going to pray that God, through his word and through his grace, would help some of us see things just a little bit differently. Let's see if we can take the kink out of the twists. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, this is a big subject. It's way bigger than me. And yet everybody listening has at some point looked at something, heard something, done something, thought something, and said, how could that happen? How could we do something so crazy? Most people in the world don't think about those kind of things. They just tend to go along with the culture. Father, would you use the next 4 or 5 weeks not to scare us, but to get our thinking where we can see things from your perspective and not just ours. Father, for the men and women who are caught in this kind of stuff and they wonder how they're going to get out, I pray the world will become untwisted. For men and women facing marital issues today and they can't seem to get past them, I pray that they would have a common enemy and it's not each other, but it is the devil. I pray that parents and kids having problems would recognize they have a common enemy and it's not each other. I pray that they would see the problem. The problem is found in an invisible world, but there is a God who sees both worlds and can navigate us through. I trust you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Last thing before you go, I forgot to mention it before the offering. This week is our last Sunday if you want to get something in, or this week as a gift to Robert, being our youth pastor for the last 12 and a half years. We're going to honor him with a special gift. Put it in an envelope. If you write a check, make it to New Hope, but on the envelope write Robert or write youth pastor, and we'll all go to that. We'll have a special day honoring him. Thank you. Have a great day. Pastor Emeritus, you can go say happy birthday to him.